Welcome. I want to give the floor to University of Chicago, because this is their venue, and this is the second time we're doing it here with you.
Yes.
First with their very distinguished Professor Martha Nussbaum, was Anger and Revolutionary Justice, which was an extremely exciting talk. So before I go and rant a little bit about how bad our education systems are and why we need to do some things about it, I want to give the floor and maybe a few words.
Sure. Thank you.
Aditi.
Thank you. Good evening, everybody. My name is Aditi Modi, and I'm the Executive Director here at the University of Chicago Center in Delhi. And we're delighted to be partnering this evening with the UNESCO MGIP series. As Dr. Ananta Duriappa mentioned, this is our second partnership with them. And we were very delighted to have our very own faculty member, Professor Martha Nussbaum, be the keynote lecturer last year. In establishing the center in Delhi, the University of Chicago actually draws upon a very long and rich history of excellence in scholarship, research, and teaching that is related to South Asia. In fact, our Department of South Asia Studies celebrated 60 years of collaboration last year. The center in Delhi, in the last 2.5 years that we have opened, has already become a base for undergraduate, graduate, and professional students studying in India. It catalyzes interdisciplinary and cross-cultural discourse and rigorous debate and intense inquiry for which the university is very well known. It is also the site of regular programming for both our alumni and interested citizens in Delhi. Among our many initiatives, we have the Energy Policy Institute at Chicago, which is based right here at the center. And this consists of an interdisciplinary team of experts that translate cutting-edge research into real impacts through strategic outreach and training for the next generation of global energy leaders. So EPIC, in the short time that it has been established here in Delhi, already works with the Ministry of Environment and Forest, the pollution control boards in the states of Gujarat, Maharashtra, and Tamil Nadu to pilot India's first ever emissions trading program for particulate matter, the deadliest form of air pollution and something that we all are very familiar with in Delhi. Under our IIC fellowship, top performing graduate students from the University of Chicago and Indian universities are selected and recruited in teams to work with various government organizations across the country on a year-long fellowship that implements innovative solutions to important development programs. The new Tata Center for Development, which we recently announced, is led by the Harris School of Public Policy and in collaboration with the Tata Trust, integrates evidence-based policy research in key areas of water, public health, energy, and environment. So those are just some of the work that we do here at the University of Chicago. And of course, our website is mentioned here, uchicago.in. So I hope that you will go to our website and register and attend. We have a whole range of programming. We do almost one event every 3 days. So with that, let me pass it now to Anamika. I think she's going to do the next round of introductions.
Yes. Good evening. Thank you, Aditi, for introducing the U Center to us. I now invite Dr. Ananta Duraiappa, Director of UNESCO MGIP, to introduce the work that MGIP does and also to introduce our very distinguished speaker for today's evening.
I'm going to do it very, very, very quickly. I want to tell you a little bit about the institute because it is UNESCO's youngest institute, but it has the privilege of being the first Category 1 in Asia-Pacific. I think that's a major achievement, because all the other six are, as usual, in the north part of the world. I also get, very quickly, so the name is the Mahatma Gandhi Institute, and it's a mouthful on education for peace and sustainable development. I think the acronym was so long they decided to drop the S, but we do sustainable development as well. And I always say, what's the key objective? And I would sort of say, at a very broad scale, it's about building peaceful and sustainable societies, but through education. That's our focus, through education. And how do we do it? We do it through learning knowledge as a key constituency. Now, because many of you are from University of Chicago, and also come from the bastion of very traditional economics as well. So I'm going to take a stab at economics as an economist by training. As a key constituency of human flourishing, so we're going back to Aristotle, Socrates, and even Shankaracharya, within the Indian philosophy. And more recently with Amartya Sen's switch towards capability and functioning. So we've switched it, we've flipped it. Education is not about producing human capital. It's about the human flourishing. And the nice thing is we have a positive externality, as we call it in economics. It's the production of human capital. But that's an externality. That's not the end. So that's how MGIP looks at it. The approach that we take, and today we're going to hit one of them, we have the first one on critical inquiry, which our distinguished lecturer is going to talk about today. Then we have another component which we call firing Gandhi neurons. And I'm not going to talk to you about it today. Go and Google it, and you'll get an idea of what we are up to. And then the third one is the moral courage to change. So we call that MC squared. So if you have in an equation, the first two equals MC squared. So we've got Einstein's theory as well up there. A little bit now towards today's lecture. It comes at a really appropriate time because recently Stanford just released a disturbing study. It said that more than 80% of middle schoolers have no way of deferring what is a fact and what is a lie. And with the overload of information through the internet, knowledge is not a problem these days. Trying to see what is good information, how do you use that, is going to be the real challenge. And so I'm really happy to introduce to you our sixth distinguished lecturer. And if you look at all our lectures, they all challenge the status quo. So Das Gupta challenged GDP. Martha Nussbaum from Chicago was challenging the punitive systems that we have with anger and revolutionary justice. And then we had Sugita Mitra, who basically said teachers are dinosaurs and we should get rid of them, to a whole lecture room full of teachers. That was interesting. So we have people who like to disrupt. And the next person that we have as our sixth distinguished lecturer, I've got to know him only very recently, although we tended to seem to have overlapped a number of times. He was teaching at UT Austin when I was a grad student, not that he's that old, it was just that I was an old grad student. And then we were at the National University of Singapore. He, for some reason, lasted 10 years, I lasted two. But he's done some very interesting stuff. He's going to give a talk about critical inquiry. Basically, I'm going to tell you a little bit about Professor Mohanan. He's fondly referred as Mo. And in fact, now I've kind of copyrighted a trademark. When we do something like what he does, we say, let's do a Mo on him. And he's going to tell you what that is all about. Has a really distinguished career. He's done his PhD in linguistics from MIT Cambridge. Has taught at UT Austin, Stanford University, and then the National University of Singapore. He kind of messed it up with the National University, but you know, you can't always get the right credentials. But now he is at the Institute of Science Education and Research, ISER, at Pune in India. So I'm not going to take up more of his time, and I give the floor to Professor Mo, or Mo as we call him.
Very much for inviting me here, and giving me an opportunity to talk about what I consider to be one of the important aspects of education. I would like to begin with something that all of you must be familiar with now. Four medical college students tortured and killed a baby monkey a few days ago. And a large number of people watched. This was must have been quite shocking for all of us. The questions that I want to raise are, the answer should be obvious. Do these students have normal human compassion? Especially, these are medical college students. Number two, do they find pleasure in causing pain? Again, the answer should be fairly obvious. But interestingly, what about the bystanders? I'm told that there were something like 30 people watching. Have they become insensitive? And I think your answers are roughly the same as mine, so there's no point in going there. The question that I want to address is, what factors shape them to become who they are, both the the four students who did it and the students who watched it. One could hypothesize biological factors. So this could be maybe some of these traits are in the genes, and by genes I don't mean genes alone, but also all the molecular factors, the epigenetic factors, biological. It could be the prenatal development factors, because those also affect human development, including the development of mind. It could be cultural factors, and this would mean maybe our social fabric has been encouraging cruelty. I'm not saying these are the factors, I'm saying these are potential factors. It could be the stress of getting top scores, because in order to get into a medical college, you have to go through a routine of memorizing meaningless information and mechanical application without thinking. It's highly stressful activity. And when you go through a stressful activity of that kind, you know, for your 12 years of education, in order to get into a medical school, especially a prestigious medical school, then you lose some of your humanity. And this is well known that in the case of mice, for example, if you put mice under extremely stressful situations, then they start biting other mice. And maybe humans are also doing the same thing. It's quite possible. It could also be that we have designed our curriculum in such a way that some of these factors come up. All of these are potential possibilities, but I want to focus attention on the last possibility. Suppose that is true, that our education is designed in such a way that rationality is destroyed, compassion is destroyed. Notice that compassion has no place in any of the syllabuses that we have. We have only information. And if that is the case, can we redesign our educational system such that at least 30 years from now, such things will not happen, because humans will be more compassionate and they will be less violent? Is that possible? And of course, my own answer would be yes, and that has been my experience too. But to address that question, we need to have some understanding of the nature of violence and the nature of social structure that causes violence. There is, at one level, there is individual violence. So in this case, in the case of medical college students, it was just individual violence directed against a monkey. It could also be individual violence directed against other humans. And this could mean domestic violence, bullying in schools and colleges, and so on. There could also be societal violence, where you become violent towards people that you haven't even met. Okay, and this would be against other social groups. Most communal violence is of that type. My focus in this talk will be the second type of violence, not the first type. So problems of the kind that you have in invasion, in terrorism, and so on, are of that type. And about the second type of violence, the societal violence, the first question is, let me go back to the question that I raised earlier. Can education play an important role in reducing violence, societal violence, and increasing compassion at the societal level? It's easy to be compassionate towards the person that you're looking at. Even if it is in a movie, if you see a picture of a suffering person, most of us have compassion. But that when it is about far away group where we don't have a mental image of the person, then large number of people do not have any compassion. So you might be compassionate about an individual who is hungry right in front of you, but if you hear about large number of malnutrition children in Africa dying, or in India for that matter, that somehow or other doesn't seem to arouse compassion. And if your answer is that, yes, education can actually do these things, how do we design school education such that we achieve what we want to achieve for at least the next generation, or maybe 60, 50 years from now? That's a central question that I want to address. Now, I'm going to suggest that one of the components in such a curriculum, I'm not suggesting that this should be the only component, one of the components ought to be what we should call rational temper. And I'm using the term rational temper as an expanded, generalized version of what the Indian Constitution calls the scientific temper. Scientific temper is what we associate with the kind of mindset that goes with scientific inquiry. But we also have other modes of rational inquiry, such as mathematical inquiry, philosophical inquiry, and so on. And so I'm expanding scientific temper as rational temper, which is the foundation for rational inquiry. If we help our students develop the quality of rational temper, I would like to suggest, many of these societal problems can be reduced, if not eliminated. And I will explain why that's a possibility. And to do that, I'm going to suggest that the rational temper has a role in two aspects. One is certain intellectual predispositions, which will play an important role in reducing violence. And these intellectual predispositions have to do with beliefs that can lead to violence. So if you believe, for example, that a certain group of humans are actually subhumans, like, for example, the belief that we used to have until recently that blacks are inferior to the whites. If they are inferior to the whites, there is no problem in enslaving them or torturing them and so on. They are not really human. This is exactly what happened in the case of medical college students. Monkeys are not human. Monkeys are inferior to humans. And by the same logic, it should be the case that handicapped people are also less human. You can torture them. It's not a problem. This is exactly what allowed the same kind of treatment that was meted out to the Jews in Hitler's Germany. The other is the set of emotional predispositions. I'll explain in a moment what I mean by predispositions. These are not actually emotions, but mental, long-standing mental states that trigger certain emotional reactions. So hatred, for example, if you hate a person, then you tend to become angry with that person. Hatred is a long-standing mental state, but anger is something that comes up and goes away. And if you dislike a person, if you hate a person, that predisposition lends itself to anger, and that leads to violence. And rational temper, if we acquire rational temper, then that temper has some significant role to play in reducing those negative emotional predispositions. So my talk will consist of two parts. One is I would like to look at the roots of societal violence, and then I will look at what education can do to solve some of the problems of those roots. So part one, violence could come from greed or desire for power. So invasion typically is of that type. Violence can come from some of these emotional predispositions that I talked about, typically of us and them nature, societal identities, especially things like communal violence and terrorism come from that. And I need to explain what I mean by emotional predisposition a little more in relation to emotions. As I said, emotions are mental occurrence events in our mind. Irritation happens, irritation dies out. Rage, road rage happens and it dies out. And predispositions are the basis for those emotions. There are also some of these emotional predispositions are attitude towards others. So irritability doesn't have a direction. So if you have some, let's say if you have a migraine headache, then you become irritable. It may also be that certain personalities are prone to bad-tempered people. They are maybe lifelong bad-tempered. But that bad temper is not directed towards anybody. But hostility, on the other hand, is directed towards someone and some group. Those are special cases of predispositions. And the question that I want to address is, can education do something about such predispositions and attitudes? And I'm going to suggest that some of these come from mutually incompatible identities, but we have to understand that some of the identities are not mutually incompatible. I have an identity as an Indian, I have an identity of a researcher, but there's no conflict between them. I can be both. So these are mutually compatible identities are pretty much harmless. So I have an identity as a gray-haired person, I have an identity as a researcher, I have an identity as a linguist, I have an identity as a painter. There are no conflicts between them. We can be all of them. But some of them are mutually incompatible. And this one, an example would be, you cannot be both an Indian and a Pakistani. By and large, national identities are mutually exclusive. There are very few countries which will allow, okay, you can be a citizen of six countries. And that creates us and them feelings. Identity of a researcher doesn't create that kind of stuff. Researchers don't kill painters, and painters don't kill researchers, typically. Religious identities, Hindu versus Muslim. Again, if you are a Hindu, you cannot be a Muslim. If you are a Muslim, you cannot be a Hindu. These are mutually exclusive, like passports. And these mutually exclusive, if you look at violence and the history of violence, by and large, a large majority of them stem from these mutually exclusive identities. So if you understand the nature of those identities, perhaps we can reduce some forms of violence, not all forms. Okay, so the question would be, how do we design a form of education that can lead to better humanity in these matters? What would be the role of education? And I'm going to focus on the intellectual component of education, not the emotional component of education. There are ways of educating emotions of the kind, for example, that happens in Buddhist techniques of mindfulness meditation. I'm going to focus on the intellectual part. This has two roles. One is what I would call building the self. And that means helping students to become aware of the nature of their identities, the nature of their mutually exclusive us and them identities. And there are various activities that we can help the students engage with so that they become self-aware and the nature of these problematic nature of their identities. I will explain what I mean by that with a few examples very soon. The other is not only understanding the nature of their identities, but doubting those things. Okay, this is where rational inquiry comes in, self-doubt. And when self-doubt comes in, certainties disappear. And many of forms of violence that we have come from total certainty. Scientific inquiry, and even in general rational inquiry, does not allow total certainty. It encourages self-doubt. So let me give you an example. From now on, I'm going to take you through a large number of examples. If you look at concepts like people, region, nation, nationalism, let's say the question that the identity, I am an Indian, okay, versus those people are Pakistanis, those people are French, and so on. So let me take you through an experience of mine teaching class 6 students. I asked students a number of questions which triggered certain moral principles. I will not go through the details of that, but the students in class 6 came up with the principle that killing others is morally objectionable. This is part of every religion, every community that you can think of. And I wrote it down on the green board. And then one student said, but you can kill everybody, you can kill enemies. That's okay. There is no harm in killing enemies. It's only killing our own people that is objectionable. So I said, okay. So this happened in Pune. So I asked him, do you have any enemies in this classroom? They said, no, we don't have any enemies here. So I said, okay, do you have any enemies in Pune? They said, no, we don't have any enemies in Pune. Any enemies in Maharashtra? No. Any enemies in India? No. So I said, where are your enemies? You don't seem to have any enemies. And all of them said, no, Pakistanis are our enemies. So I said, okay, so we can go and kill all the Pakistanis. They said, yes. Sixth grade students, okay? No harm, it's okay, it's a good thing to kill all Pakistanis. So I said, okay, let's do that. But there is a, right now when we are having this classroom, there is a school in Pakistan, a sixth grade students, exactly like this, there is a teacher teaching those students. Let's go and kill those students first. They said, no, 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 you can't kill those students. So I said, so students are not your enemies? They said, no, others are. So I said, okay, how about killing the adults? They said, yes, you can kill the adults. So I said, okay, well, let's begin by killing the parents of those children. And they said, no. Okay, this is something they had never thought about. So I said, in which case, students are not your enemies, adults are not your enemies. Who are your enemies? Pakistani soldiers. Let's go kill the Pakistani soldiers. So I said, good. So some of those Pakistani soldiers have mothers, they have children. And so we will kill those soldiers. The children will become parentless. And that caused tremendous amount of confusion. And finally, they decided, no, you can't kill the soldiers either. So we said, okay, who are enemies then? They said, enemies are people who want to kill others. At least it changed into, we didn't continue this discussion because it is only sixth grade. So this is an example of how we can transform attitudes through rational inquiry. All that I did was simply ask questions. The students came to this realization on their own. I did not lecture to them. I did not preach sermons. Preaching sermons hardly has an effect. With parents, let me describe something similar. Again, parents also have similar problems. So we asked this question, who is an Indian? And we asked, was Gandhi an Indian? And they said, yes, of course. So I said, who is an Indian? They said, anybody who is born in India. So I said, okay, when did India come to existence? India as a political unit? Well, when India became independent, that was long after Gandhi was born. So Gandhi was born before India came into existence, therefore Gandhi is not an Indian. So they got very confused and they had to, the crucial technique here is define the concept and look at the consequences of your definition. So they said, no, that's not the definition, not somebody who is born in India, somebody who is born in the territory that is now called India. All right, that also is problematic, okay? Because then you would ask about people who are born in the territory that is now called Pakistan, you will have to say they are not Indians. We went through various definitions, people who have Indian passports, who have, you know, so on. None of that worked. And then we came to the conclusion that being an Indian, that has two meanings. One is in terms of the government, in terms of a political unit, in terms of a boundary, which these things keep shifting. If you look at the history, there were many countries in this region, and it's very interesting to look at those changing, shifting boundaries of nationhoods. But there is also another identity with the people, regardless of the government. Then the question would be, do we have the same sense of identity with the people that we now call Pakistanis? So if you're sitting in a restaurant and talking to somebody in Hindi, and you don't realize what the passport is, do we feel an affinity with that other person? That's a different kind of Indianness. Okay? And these two notions of I am an Indian are not exactly the same. Okay? And if you have the second notion, then you can expand that to being a South Asian is an identity. Then, of course, ultimately, being a human is an identity. Being a living creature is an identity. And these are not mutually exclusive identities. Let me continue that example. Okay, I actually talked about nations as political entities versus nations as sociocultural entities. And these are distinct notions. The question that I want to raise is, do we have a choice in our political identities? If you're born in some country, it's not easy to change your passport and have a passport from another country. Okay. And also, if you have a passport from one country, it's not easy to get a passport from another country. At the same time, you cannot have passports from two different countries. That is at the root of one of these problems, that you cannot have multiple national identities, the political type. And we don't have a choice, we simply inherit it. By and large, it is decided by your birth. And you can't, as I said, you cannot belong to multiple nations. Let me take another example of the similar nature, which is religion. Again, religion also is mutually exclusive identities, and both nationalities and national identities and religious identities cause violence, have caused huge amounts of violence in the whole history of humanity. A few years ago, when I was in Singapore, one of the teachers in the in a United World College nearby called me and said, can you come and do a workshop on religious inquiry with students? These are ninth grade students. So I said, fine, why did you suddenly call me? So she said, I have two or three fundamentalists in my class, and I don't know what to deal with them. They think people of other religions should be killed. So I said, okay, I'll come and try my best. So I went there and asked them to write down a few things. First question was, do you believe in God? Write it down, you don't have to tell me. Next question, if you believe in God, do you also believe in heaven and hell? And they wrote it down. So if you believe in hell, the third question was, if you believe in hell, do you think if you don't believe in the God that you believe in, will that God send you to hell? So let's say I am a Christian and I believe in Christian God, and if I don't accept that God, will that God send me to hell? Interestingly, many students, actually, I know that many students believe that if you don't have belief in a particular God, then you will be sent to hell. This was the third question. The fourth question was, okay, assume for the moment that at the time of your birth, you were adopted by some other parents. So your biological parents and adopted parents are different, and they have two different religions. And now, what would be your religion now if you're adopted by some other parents? The answer is obvious. Your religion will not be the same. It'll be some other religion. My fifth question was, if your religion is different, it is based on the adopted parents' religion, will the God of your biological parents send you to hell? And I could see that students were visibly shaken, that they were completely confused. Okay, I said, you don't have to tell me anything, just think about it. And then I continued with some other aspects of religious inquiry. And I continued with the question, how do we define the concept of God? That was, the rest of the session was about that question. And the teacher called me about 2 weeks later and said that these fundamentalist students came to her and said, we are no longer certain of our beliefs, which is a huge accomplishment. Okay, now these students who are no longer certain will not go and kill a member of some other religious community simply because they think that God has ordered them to kill other members of other religious communities. This is where rational inquiry comes in, to diffuse certainties, total certainties, which will cause violence. I have raised similar questions about who is a Hindu. So questions like, if I'm an atheist, can I be a Hindu? And many adults get confused by that question. And then I raise questions about, you know, atheism of Buddha. And in a certain sense, atheism of Shankara as well. The ultimate reality is in Shankara, the propertyless God, or propertyless Brahman, which is, in fact, we can't even call God. If you start looking at philosophical traditions, then it's unclear what the word Hindu means. But that question takes several weeks of discussion. It's not as easy as what I did with students. The same difficulty that we saw with nations, we have in religions. because you can belong only to one religion at a time. We don't have a choice, and we cannot belong to multiple religions. One solution to the problem of religious violence will be to allow for multiple religious memberships. So if we can have people who are Christians, Muslims, and Hindus at the same time, a lot of religious violence will be eliminated simply because of that. Or if you allow within a family, some members of the family are Hindus, others are Christians, others are Muslims, others are Jews, and so on. You obviously don't want to kill other members of other religions because you will then be killing members of your own family. I kind of hinted at this, the blind faith that we have that causes violence of, I am right and you are wrong. Unquestioning faith in statements of this kind. And this can happen in matters of truth, matters of moral rightness, matters of effective action, and so on. Total certainty leads to violence. So let me give you some examples of total certainty in religious faith. So in the Bible, it says, the New Testament, that Jesus was the Son of God and ascended to heaven in his body. This is taken as a non-negotiable truth. You cannot doubt it. In Quran, it says Jesus was not the Son of God. He was a prophet, and he did not ascend to heaven in his body. They are both holy texts. So I asked a friend of mine, okay, given this contradictory statements in two holy texts, how do you figure out which position you want to accept? So he said to me, that is obvious. So I said, how is it obvious? Because he said, Quran is the word of God, Bible is not. So this is a person who is also interested in solving the problems of fanaticism and religious violence and so on. And I tried talking to him for about 5 minutes. Nothing was entering, so I just gave up. Okay. And the same kind of belief that says, if you say Hanuman jumped across the ocean, okay, if you believe it with total certainty, the literal truth of scriptures is always dangerous. Now, I am not attacking religion. Why do people have these totally certain beliefs of this kind, which I call blind faith? Blind faith is not restricted to religion, okay? Blind faith is also part of our education, blind faith in academic texts. So let me give you some examples of that. All of you believe that the earth revolves around the sun. I'm pretty sure with total certainty. It cannot be wrong, right? Why do you believe that? What are the reasons? Why do you reject the geocentric theory that the sun goes around the earth? Okay, I've asked this question to many audiences. If you get one person out of 100 who can give a coherent answer, I would be totally delighted. Okay, so let me put this to you. You have blind faith in this statement of the textbook. Our education does not tell us what the reasons for this belief are. Okay, this is not any different from believing that Jesus was the Son of God or Jesus was only a prophet. There is no difference between religious blind faith and the so-called blind faith in the textbook dogmas. Again, all of you believe that matter is made up of indivisible units, accepting Democritus' view as opposed to Aristotle's view. Anybody knows the evidence for it? Again, people who have done science, physics or chemistry, undergraduate degrees, quite often tell me that they know the reasons, and it's 5 minutes. 5 minutes are enough to indicate that they really do not know the reasons. They think they know the reasons. I will not go into the demonstration, but it's easy to demonstrate that many of us do not know the reasons. All of us believe, I think, that except for creationists, that humans evolved from unicellular organisms, that humans were not created on the sixth day of creation from dirt. Why do you believe that? As far as educated people are concerned, majority of educated people, whether you believe in the creationist dogma that humans were created afresh from clay, or humans evolved from unicellular organism, they are both dogmas, they are both aspects of blind faith. Whether it is scientific or religious, it doesn't really matter. They are both blind faith. The moment you ask the questions, why do I believe such and such things, and start investigating the reasons, your certainty in all these matters would disappear. You will say, okay, I'm almost convinced that this is true, but I could be wrong. And the moment you say I could be wrong, it has an effect on religious dogmas as well. So we have to begin with science and then go on to religion. The reason why there is so much of religious fundamentalism today is because our education has failed. Our education is indoctrinating us with academic blind faith in academic textbooks. That's what we have to stop. Religion would take care of itself after that. And as I said, the answer to these questions would be because our textbook says so. If that answer is valid, then the answer because our holy scriptures tell us is also valid. There's no difference. And if in a form of education that addresses questions of this kind, people will have uncertainty, degrees of uncertainty, not total certainty. They will doubt themselves. And that rational temper will help us look at ourselves more carefully, look at our beliefs, look at our actions in a rational fashion. At least half the violence would disappear. We also have to educate our emotional self, which I'm not getting into in this talk. Okay, I'm going to skip the other examples because I'm running short of time. I was expecting a talk of 16 hours, but I didn't realize. Okay, I do want to give you a brief idea of this one. One of the teachers that I was engaging with came and asked me, are mushrooms microorganisms? I said, huh? Because the teacher should know that. She asked me this question because in the seventh standard textbook, it says that following statements, microorganisms are things that you cannot see with your naked eye. You need microscopes. A page later, it says that fungi are microorganisms. And one page later, it says mushrooms are fungi. The conclusion is that mushrooms are microorganisms, therefore you cannot see mushrooms with naked eye. Okay. Now, if people start looking at textbooks from that perspective, gradually they discover that textbooks can be wrong completely. I have a large number of examples of this kind from various textbooks. And we teach students how to identify such statements in textbooks. And if they develop a certain degree of healthy disrespect for textbooks, they will also extend that attitude to other aspects of life. I will not go into these complications. It'll take a lot of time. So they have some consequences to this societal violence coming from, I am right and you are wrong, therefore it's okay to kill you because you are wrong. Or you are an evil person because you don't belong to my group, and it's okay to hate you because you don't share my beliefs. So let me re-ask the question that I asked earlier. Can education help the young develop the intellectual predispositions this time? Sidestepping the issue of emotional predisposition, that also has to be addressed. Can these intellectual predispositions develop compassion, develop the ability to heal ourselves from the predispositions for violence, and more importantly, protect ourselves from academic, religious, and political indoctrination? And of course, my answer is yes. And what can we do? The group of people that I work with, we call ourselves THINK. This is THINK, TH for THINK, IN for inquiry, and Q for question. We have dedicated ourselves to helping students develop these capacities for rational inquiry. And we are currently pursuing the strategy of replacing current mainstream education policies of giving students training in information recall, mechanical skills, and academic indoctrination with an education that is oriented towards critical thinking, inquiry, and integration. I've just given you a very brief taste of what that means, but I hope you understand that. And if you look at our website, you will see a huge number of examples, videos, PDF files, and so on, which are designed to develop these qualities. We also run courses for teachers and students. So our activities include online courses, on critical thinking, inquiry, and integration. Critical thinking and inquiry as school subject, and this involves both students and teachers. We are planning at this point to collaborate with MGIP to create an online course on inquiry and critical thinking for 8th grade students all over the world. So far, our scope has been within India alone, but if this course is developed, it can be used by everybody within or outside India. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Mo, for injecting a sense of skepticism in our mind. I'm sure we have a lot of questions. So, yes, sir, please.
I guess I am right in inferring that how can rational inquiry help us evolve as better human beings or better world, whatever. I have a problem here. Newtonian physics, scientific materialism on the one hand, which has created many social science disciplines also rooted in that paradigm. And then mysticism, quantum physics, and lately many quantum life universities are popping up all over the world, even in India. And then they also say ours is a rational inquiry. Consciousness has created the matter, unlike the earlier kind of thing. And despite 100 years of quantum physics, still the even for adults, scientific materialism-based discussion in the classrooms is ruling the roost. So what kind of rational inquiry, when will the correct rational inquiry emerge and influence the mindsets of the human beings on planet Earth?
Yeah. By rational temper, I don't mean the belief that whatever the science textbook tells us is true and everything else is wrong. I mean the capacity to investigate, not the content knowledge of Newtonian physics or quantum physics. For us, it is not the assertions that textbooks make that are important, actually that are hardly important for us. It is the ability to challenge Newtonian physics, the ability to challenge quantum physics. But that is at a higher stage. But at the school level, the ability to challenge what science textbooks tell us and to figure out what to believe, what not to believe, and what to keep on hold. That ability is the capacity for rational inquiry. And the reason why we have not been able to get over many of these problems is because only science content is taught. Scientific inquiry is hardly ever taught. Nobody teaches students how to construct a scientific theory. Nobody teaches students how to choose between two competing scientific theories. Nobody teaches students even to design a scientific experiment. They only teach them how to implement scientific experiments. And therefore, rational temper is completely missing in our education. Rational temper is missing even among people who work as scientists. And this is reasonably well known. And let me also add, by rational temper, I don't mean scientific temper alone. Philosophical inquiry of the kind that you mentioned is also part of rational inquiry. So there is no conflict between the Buddhistic rational inquiry and scientific rational inquiry. They work hand in hand. They are not opposed to each other. So as I mentioned, the problems arise because we haven't been doing that in our schools and colleges. We have failed. Education has failed us.
A very good evening. Okay. A very good evening to you. My name is Rishi, and I have two questions. The first emerges from an essay that I read a while ago, which talks about how there was a, I mean, this is a philosophical meandering, so it might be totally off point when it comes to the scientific basis of it. But it basically hypothesized that there was a beautiful point in human history when you could be a Renaissance man, right? When scientific development was at the point where you could still walk into your house and understand all the basic things and how they worked scientifically, how basic electricity, AC/DC, those things. And it argues that that point has passed. Transcendental knowledge becomes more and more important because we're living in a world that is, you know, it's a conflation of Moore's law. Things are changing at a pace where it becomes almost impossible to be skeptical towards the body of science that you're trying to consume if you want to make any progress further. That's my first question. How do you place that in the middle of this? And the second one...
Come back to your second question later. One question, please.
All right.
Okay. I have difficulty in remembering the...
Okay.
At the level of information, you're right. There is so much information to absorb that no human being can absorb all the information, even in one discipline. It's impossible. So there's no point in trying that. But there is a slightly different way of designing education, not on the basis of information, but the core concepts that I would call transdisciplinary concepts. So chemical change is a discipline-specific change, but the concept of change cuts across disciplinary boundaries, physics, chemistry, biology, human history. The concept of evolution is relevant for physical evolution, biological evolution, cultural evolution. The concept of structure is transdisciplinary, but the concept of atomic structure is discipline-specific. So if we help students develop those transdisciplinary concepts, we will be Renaissance people at that level. We may not have all the details, so you may not be able to answer the question, what is the molecular structure of methane molecule? Is that important? No. But the important question is, what is the evidence for assuming a certain kind of structure in chemistry? That I think we can understand. So some of these broad aspects of knowledge, which I call transdisciplinary, it is possible to do so. The other part is also the inquiry attitudes and habits. So I know this equation E is equal to mc squared. I'm not a physicist, so I cannot answer the question, why should I believe that E is equal to mc squared is true? I may have answers for some aspects, but not everything. But the important part is realizing that I don't have the evidence for it. Okay? I know that I don't have the evidence for it, and I also know I may not have the mathematical capacity to investigate those things in great detail. Once you have that attitude, and once you have that capacity to investigate at your level of specialization, then the kinds of problems that I raised can be solved. It is understanding what we have evidence for and understanding what we may not know. Evidence might exist, but we are not aware of it. That is the important part, for which I think we can all be Renaissance persons. I teach biology to students at ISA, and they know much more biology than me. What I teach is not specialized knowledge, but the broader transdisciplinary concepts. And I teach, I venture into mathematics and chemistry and neuroscience and so on. But I know that I don't have the specialized knowledge in any of these subjects. That's possible at that level.
In the current scheme of events that we are witnessing in in the United States and in India, there seems to be a very strong opposition towards intellectualism, and it's being associated with elitism. And there is a very polarized discourse taking place, and there are trends occurring in a lot of countries which we are witnessing. In such a vitiated atmosphere, how does one seek to achieve the middle ground in our debates and discussions, where instead of making things binary, where the liberal school of thought is completely disconnected from perhaps the ground realities and vice versa, for that matter. How does one try to achieve that within the constraints that we have in education and in political discourse?
I don't think I have a very good answer to that question, so let me make a suggestion. One of the reasons perhaps could be that there is no debate between two camps. Assertions are made, personal opinions are made. So take, for example, the assertion that astrology is true on the part of, let us say, ordinary people, and the statement that astrology is all false by scientists. They are both acting on blind faith. All right? A scientist should actually say, I have not seen any evidence relevant to the question, are the astrological alleged correlations between the time of birth and human events, are those claims true? Nobody has looked at that question. Okay? So scientists should be saying, I haven't seen the evidence, rather than saying it is false. And the other party should be saying, I have seen some of those things working out, so maybe it is true. If you say that, they can have a dialogue between them. The same thing would happen to things like homeopathy and so on. So the conflict between the so-called elite and the non-elite is really because they're both asserting their opinions without engaging in rational inquiry. And the reason why they're not engaging in rational inquiry is because they haven't had any experience of rational inquiry in their entire education. So we can do up to a PhD. You can have a PhD without being educated. That's the problem that our schooling does to us. So if we can actually ensure that our degrees really give us education, this will not happen, is my guess.
Thank you, Mo. We have time for last two questions.
I want to share with you a predicament. There is the so-called big lie theory of human behavior. The sun rises in the south, I can say. The propaganda minister of Nazi Germany used big lies to achieve whatever sinister goals. University of Chicago has been selling a big lie, lying fame, that the free markets are the best way of organizing economic activity, and there is a bunch of scholarship which will give you tons of, you know, statements that there is no hard evidence. And we are all now, if I follow the blind faith of University of Chicago, I will not get a job. I will be poo-pooed and ostracized. And so I have to go through that. There are rational inquiries have emerged out of this blind faith, a lot of mathematical illustrations and a lot of gymnastics in the classroom. I have to learn them to be accepted as a scholar in my own intellectual community. So this is a self-deception. I have to live my life with self-deception.
Yeah, but the way I have defined rational inquiry, believing in what your community believes is not rational. Rational inquiry is actually challenging those things. And we cannot expect changes within our generation. We have become too old. The only change that can happen is in our children. So at least our grandchildren will have a better world. We cannot change the mindset of people who have crossed 50. Okay? It's very difficult. We have become fossilized. So we can help our children develop into rational human beings with compassion, with understanding. We are lost. Okay, because our education has made us become irrational.
The lady asked the question.
My question is about the role of fear in violence. Where do you, you know, put the instinct of fear in violence? You talked about greed and power, but fear also leads to violence. And, you know, what is your concept about it?
Yeah. I'm not quite sure if all problems of violence can be solved through rational inquiry. The best that we can do with fear is look at fear and find out if the fear is legitimate, okay? So I'll give you a small example. I was brought up in an environment, in a village, where ghosts were completely real for me. And my brain has inherited that. The brain hasn't completely given up that fear. As a rational person, I do not believe that ghosts exist. But my emotional self continues to believe in ghosts. So I have gone to cemeteries at night, midnight, to check if I have fear. I'm terrified. I go to the cemetery and I can feel my body tightening up. But I know that ghosts don't exist. So my rational self tells my emotional self, stupid person, why are you afraid of ghosts? But my emotional self doesn't listen. Minimally, what we can do is to separate these two aspects so that I don't act on the basis of my emotion of fear. My rational self would say, watch out, don't do ridiculous things. That's the best we can do. Some fears are not removable through rational inquiry alone, but rationality can act as a counterpoint. That's the best we can do. I have not been successful in controlling my emotional self.
Thank you so much for your brilliant presentation. In terms of how education can help, you use the words like compassion, empathy, etc. We are trying to introduce emotional intelligence and the whole idea of multiple intelligence, looking not just at book smart, but other ways of looking at intelligence. Would the introduction of emotional intelligence help in terms of looking at the issues that you have just raised in terms of blind faith, in terms of violence, in terms of fear?
It's absolutely essential, but I would say not the pop concept of emotional intelligence,
no.
But I would subscribe to the kind of research that, for example, Dalai Lama and MIT are doing together. There's a huge amount of work that Buddhist monks and scientists are working together in developing some of these things, testing, for example, mindfulness practices and so on. So along with the kind of rational inquiry project that we are pursuing, if you also have some education of the emotions through mindfulness practice, and I would especially recommend something like Paul Ekman's work on emotions. And there are many others. I don't, you know, there's a huge team of people who are doing that. And both have to be part of the school curriculum. I'm talking only about one of the strands. That's necessary but hardly sufficient. It has to be combined with the other strand. And they go extremely well hand in hand.
But the challenge that we have is when you talk about self-awareness, which, because you mentioned two issues, raising self-awareness. But the other issue, which is very difficult, is doubting yourself.
Yeah.
How does it?
I think this is part of the Buddhist attitude towards life, that doubting is combined with conviction. There is a movie called Agora. This is about a 4th century woman mathematician, Hypatia, mathematician, scientist, philosopher. And she is, at the end of the movie, she has this conversation with two people, one a bishop and the other one a Roman administrator. Both were her students. And she is asked to kiss the Bible, otherwise she would be killed. And she refuses to. And they tell her, look, we are all similar, so we are trying to help you. We are made out of the same fabric or something to that effect. And she says, no, there is a fundamental difference between us. You will not and cannot doubt what you believe. I must. Okay? She's not saying I will, but I must. It's a responsibility of a rational mind to doubt what you believe. And for many people, that statement makes no sense. How can you doubt what you believe? But that is the gift of scientific inquiry, the capacity to doubt what you are convinced by and keeping that together. It takes students something like 2 or 3 years to develop that capacity through rigorous rational inquiry. But once students have that capacity, I think we don't have to teach them. They're free.
So my question particularly, you said school and rationality.
Like that. Yeah.
Oh, hello. It's audible.
Yeah.
Yeah. My question is, you said we should question.
I can't hear you. Can you hold it like this? Yeah.
My question is, like you said, we should, like, there should be blind faith. There should be a middle path, rational thinking. But when you put it in school, say, our minds, shouldn't it start at a base level, that we have certain base background and then question it, rather than in putting something right from the start, starting from a college level? Our minds are so not very developed, because if we start questioning from a very start, shouldn't it lead to a lot of confusion, a lot of chaos?
It's difficult for me to answer the question crisply, as Sanamika put it. But it can begin at age 3. Our granddaughter asks us questions, and we engage with her at that level. She's not going to ask me questions about quantum mechanics. But when we ask her to do something, she says, why? Rather than saying, because I told you so, if you try to reason with her, okay, at that level, it is possible. My wife teaches rational inquiry, or has started teaching rational inquiry, for class 2 students. Again, she's not going to assume specialized knowledge. So rational inquiry is possible, not in-depth rational inquiry of a professional mathematician, a professional scientist, and so on, but at that level. So the point I'm making is that when we tell the students that the Earth goes around the sun, it has to be at an age when they can understand the reasons for it. So telling fifth grade students that the Earth goes around the sun is meaningless, because they cannot engage with it. Why not delay it till, let us say, ninth grade? And at that point, rather than telling students that this is true, let the students come up with that decision. You give the phenomena that are important for that conclusion, and let the students have discussions among themselves and come to the conclusion that the Earth goes around the sun. If you rearrange the syllabus in that way, it can begin from, you know, at age 3, age 5, and so on. It's a question of choosing the right kind of level of rational inquiry, not in-depth, highly specialized knowledge, but at a basic level. So my 6th grade students can debate on the question, what is fairness? But I don't think they can debate on the question, what is science? So we don't let the students debate on that one in 6th grade. Maybe they can do it to the undergraduate level, not before that.
Thank okay. you so you much, Mom. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yeah. I now invite I would now like to invite Dr. Karan Singh to do the closing. But before he does so, he needs no introduction. He's a member of India's Upper House of Parliament and is also India's representative to UNESCO's Executive Board. He received his Padma Vibhushan in 2005, and we are very honored to have him at MGIP as the chair of a governing board. So Dr. Singh, please.
There are two scenarios for the future of the human race. One is Arthur Koestler, the European philosopher. He holds that the human race is a race programmed for self-destruction because of an engineering defect in the cortex and the emotion. So that you know what you have to, should do, but you don't do it. Like Duryodhana in the Mahabharata says, Janami dharmam, nacha me pravritti, janami adharmam, nacha me nivritti. I know what is right, but I'm not attracted to it. I know what is wrong, but I'm attracted to it. What do you do? So the other alternative is Sri Aurobindo's scenario of the human race programmed for evolution. That sooner or later, evolution has not finished with the human race. Like it has come from the primeval ocean, from the slime for billions of years, it will go on beyond human and mind will go into super minds. So we have these two scenarios of the future of the human race. We don't know yet, the jury is out, but it reminds me of a limerick I heard a long time ago. God's plan made a hopeful beginning, but man spoiled his chances by sinning. We know that the story will end in God's glory, but at present the other side's winning. So, you know, I really, frankly, you know, this is a dilemma. Why are some people drawn to violence and all? You've said some interesting things about that. Is it the privity? Is it the genetic configuration? Is it the karmic debt? Whichever way you look upon it, there are various explanations, but obviously there are a large number of factors which go into it. The second point I'd like to make is about religion. I have been involved in the interreligious dialogue now for 40 years. In fact, Aditi also was involved with me at one stage in that. And it is extraordinary how every religion looks upon its God as compassionate. I am a worshipper of Lord Shiva, Karpur Gaurum Karuna Avatar, the embodiment of compassion. The Muslims begin their prayers, Bismillah Rahman Rahim, God the merciful, the beneficent. The Christians believe that Jesus Christ mounted the cross in order to save humanity. The Sikhs talk about the Ekamkar, all the religions, the Buddhists. And yet, in the name of many of these religions, the most terrible things take place. ISIS, cutting people's throat and televising it, are much worse than the boys who threw the dog from above, because they are supposed to be adults. So this horrific hatred that is built somehow into the human psyche. Now, the interfaith movement with which I am involved seeks to bring together in a harmonious dialogue representatives of different religions. Because whether you like it or not, religion plays a major role in our consciousness, at least in this part of the world. Perhaps in the West, it does play a major role. But whether you accept it or whether you don't, whether you like it or whether you don't. So what we have to do is to rearticulate those universal principles which are found in all the world's religions. You talked of Buddhism. The Upanishads are questions and all, very sharp questions. The real fundamental texts of Hinduism are the Upanishads. Even the Gita is a derivative text. It is the Upanishads which are the basic texts, the Shruti. And there it's full of questions. Everything starts with Keneshatam Brahma. Why are we here? What is the force that causes us to speak? So there's a lot of what you may call rationality or questioning built into many, at least the Indic religions. That is Hinduism, Jainism, Buddhism and Sikhism. The revealed religions are slightly different because they have a text which you either accept or you don't accept. But in the Indic religions, we can question. The Gita is whole question and answers. Upanishads are questions and answers. So I think that what is important is that with all this religious polarization, the interfaith movement, in the United Nations in the year 2000, there was a big conference of spiritual leaders and political leaders. We have to work on that because neglecting religion, ultimately what has that ended in? Leaving religion to the most reactionary, revanchist and undesirable elements in each religion. Because the Indian intelligentsia, I regret to say, has not actually had the courage to address religion properly. It's either the scientists say, oh, it's all nonsense, forget it, what is this? It's some hangover from the past. Or the atheists say there's no such thing as religion. You have to address religion. What are the teachings behind the religion? What does it mean? And we have been, you know, along secularism is all very fine and large. But with secularism, we have thrown the baby out along with the bathwater also. As a result of which, we do not seem to have any sort of feel for the deeper elements in religion. And that is one of the great achievements of the human race, has been some of the great religious texts, religious ideas and ideals. And to just throw them away because we feel they are not rational or they haven't been questioned, no, I think that is unwise. You cannot throw away your scientific research, you cannot throw away your philosophical background. So I just make a point there that it's important for us to study religions and see what can be. And we've been doing that for many years now. That is something. And finally, you mentioned identities. To me, the key is the concept of multiple identities. Each one of us have multiple identities. For example, I can give you five identities. My ethnic identity, I'm a Dogra. You may not have heard of the word. It's a small community in North India, in Himachal and Jammu. I'm a Dogra. I'm proud to be a Dogra. I've grown up the Dogra. General Zorawar Singh fighting here, and so on, this and that. So I'm a Dogra regime source. Then my regional identity, I come from Jammu and Kashmir. That's a regional identity. My religious identity, I'm a Hindu. And with a religious identity, whether you like it or not, you get a caste identity. So I'm a Rajput. I've been brought up with Maharana Pratap fighting and Chhatrapati Shivaji fighting and Yevo. These are all identities. Then my national identity is I'm an Indian. Incidentally, I was not born in India. I was born in France, believe it or not. So neither in India nor in Pakistan nor in Sri Lanka. I was born in France. But I'm an Indian, that is my national identity. But I'm also a global citizen. My identity doesn't end with being an Indian. I'm a global citizen, I'm a resident of planet Earth. So these multiple identities are there, apart from being in politics or being an author or whatever. So my view is that if we can develop an inner center strong enough to center our personality, then it doesn't matter how many concentric center circles you have around it, you are fine. It's when the center shifts, when you become eccentric, then you start becoming paranoid, then you start becoming violent, then you start becoming evil and horrible. So it's very important, that's why I feel, and it's something which the rationalists tend to throw away, the importance of developing what I would call an inner spiritual center. Professor Mohanan will say, how do you know there's a spiritual center? Okay. You know, the only problem is if you live in a paroxysm of doubt all your life, as Professor Mohanan seems to suggest, then I don't see how you're going to get anywhere. You have to have some kind of a belief. Bilkul hi aise hawa ki tarah udte raho, idhar se ja raha hai, udhar se ja raha hai. How do I know I'm here? How do I know that I'm sharing the thing? You know, okay, I'm sorry, I'm just pulling your leg a bit. I think it's important. But you know, I don't like this paroxysm of doubt thing. I'm not saying that your beliefs should be very fanatic at all. But I do have certain beliefs, and I think those beliefs have helped me in my life.
It's a question of choice between pessimism and optimism. We have both God and devil built into our genes. The question is, which will win? I don't know. But I'm in the game of education because I'm optimistic. That's all we can go by. This is not a rational conclusion with total certainty, but I choose to believe, I chose my words carefully, I choose to believe that if we can help our students develop certain rational capacities, the world will go in one direction. Am I totally certain about that? No, but this is the best bet I can have. As an educator, that's what I do. And if I didn't believe that, I will not be an educator. I will go do poultry farming or something else. Why should I be in? Okay. That's one. The second part, multiple identities, I completely agree with you. In fact, my whole point was it is mutually exclusive identities that are causing harm. So when my daughter asked me when she was about 6 years old what my religion was, I kind of scratched my head and said, I don't really know. I think I am a Hindu and a Buddhist and a Christian. And she said, who are you primarily? And again, I wasn't quite sure. I said, I think I'm primarily a Hindu, but also a Christian and a Buddhist secondarily. And I thought I was primarily a Hindu because of my cultural upbringing. I was, you know, brought up in a village with, you know, a Hindu temple and so on. After she completed her undergraduate degree, she told me, do you remember this question I had asked you? I said, yes, I do remember. And she said to me, you are wrong. I don't think you are primarily a Hindu. You may be Hindu, but you're primarily a Buddhist, only secondarily a Hindu. I said, why do you say so? She gave me a reason. I will not expand on the reasons, but you know, I accept, you know, my daughter's argument. So that helps. If we can say we are all of these, and also it's important to make a distinction between religion as a social institution and religious inquiry, which is what you're talking about in the Upanishadic tradition. That is extremely valuable. I am not denying the value of that. I'm talking about the societal construct, which is us and them religion. The other one, there is no conflict between Hindus and Christians and Muslims. We understand the unity of all religions. In fact, religious inquiry and spiritual inquiry should be part of school education. One of the reasons why we have problems is that the thing called secularism, which is actually blind faith, and religious faith, which is also blind faith, exist. Okay, both, as I mentioned, both scientists and non-scientists are equally irrational. That's the difficulty we have. Scientists are not scientific. That's a difficulty. The third thing, yes, I agree with the importance of developing the inner self. And I hope I have difficulty about more than 2 points. I forget the last
one. Doesn't matter.
Okay. Yes, but that is exactly what rational inquiry does.
Indeed.
Not scientific inquiry alone, but rational inquiry, which is an expanded form. And rational inquiry includes the Upanishadic type inquiry. In fact, I would agree with you that we should go back to that.
Yes, that is the
right
basis.
Which is actually rational inquiry.
Right. Well, 7:30. Thank you.
Next time, also to